Okay, so in this chapter we want to study weak Riemannian metrics with applications in shape analysis. And so the purpose here is twofold. Actually, we want to investigate quite closely the so-called L2 metric on a certain space of mappings. This is a mapping. This is a metric which appears a lot in shape analysis applications. So now the word has been used twice. So with shape analysis, we basically mean here, as we have already seen in the introduction, so the analysis of shapes, where we want to compute distances on an infinite dimensional manifold to compare shapes. And the shapes are modeled usually as we take a certain kind of smooth curves, and we quotient out reparametrizations. And these reparametrizations are modeled by diffeomorphisms, which we precompose with the smooth mappings. However, we have already seen several times L2 metrics, and this always entailed that we can integrate over, say, in most cases we've integrated over an interval, but for us it will be important that we can integrate over a compact manifold, and we restrict our attention here to the compact manifold S1, so to the unit circle. And I wanted to briefly recall what an integral over S1 means. So if you have seen integration on manifolds, then you will probably know this and know how to derive the results. If you have not seen integration on manifolds, then either you read up on this, so we are not going to give a full introduction to this integration on manifolds theory, because at least if your manifold is S1, we get a very nice and simple formula which drops out of the general theory. And we'll just take this as as the definition. So if you want to integrate on the manifold S1, recall that the unit circle can be parametrized by the usual parametrization using cosine and sine, sort of just rotating once around the circle here. And parametrizations usually require to be, or are usually asked to be, an injective mapping or bijective mapping between the set. And obviously, this thing is almost injective apart from the endpoints, right? So zero gets mapped to the same point as gets mapped to pi. And so we have this one double point. The reason why we want a compact interval here is because on one hand, later on, we want to integrate over the whole compact interval. So compactness is again nice here. And from the perspective of an integral, if you're doubling one point, then this is irrelevant for the integral, right? So this would be a set of measure zero if you know Lebesgue measure theory, and also for Riemannian for Riemann integral, it should be clear that if you're integrating over a single point twice, then the Riemann integral will not see that you have done that. Okay, so we use this parametrization, and then we write for a continuous function from, let's say, S1 with values in RD, so in some vector space, we just use the usual integral, where what I'm hiding here, the usual integral means, of course, the component-wise integral, right? So f of cosine t sine t will then be some sort of vector, and you can integrate every single component of the vector as a one-dimensional integral. We are often abusing notation a little bit here. So we are, theta is, at least when as it's written down above, is just this parametrization map. But since it's very convenient to abuse notation here, we'll use theta as if it were a variable. Actually, theta should be theta of t, right? So in a certain sense, the equality for the integral is like a change of variables formula for this one. Actually, we use it just here as a definition of the integral. And you can prove this from the abstract manifold integration theory that this is the right formula for at least this parameterization and this compact manifold. Okay, so in case any integrals over S1 turn up, this will be solved as basically, if you want to really compute it, it will be an integral over this interval from 0 to 2 pi where you have inserted cosine and sine. Fortunately, we will not really be interested in computing a concrete integral. I mean, this might be annoying when looking at the cosine and sine terms, which are sitting inside there, if you want to really compute what is going on. So it might be a complicated integral depending on your function f. So all we need really is here that these integrals exist. And depending on what we are going to do later on, the abstract properties of an integral we know from the finite dimension integration theory. Okay. Right. So, and for a differentiable map, we again abuse notation and write c dot of theta. And this will be t theta c of 1. So we actually, I mean, the dot notation was usually used for only for curves, right? So and a curve is something which is defined on a piece of the reals. We are abusing notation here a little bit because we have this isomorphism to the of the tangent space sitting at, let's say, theta of t, and this is isomorphic to the reals. And in the reals we have a unique copy of of 1, and we just use this t theta c of 1, and for as a shorthand we use here c dot at theta for this. So in principle, because of the parametrization we have here, this c dot is perhaps somewhat justified because a differentiable map on S1 behaves up to this periodicity, because when you're going once around the circle, behaves like a differentiable function on the closed interval from 0 to 2 pi, right? And this is what this notation is supposed to capture. Okay, so those are the integrals if we're going into RD. And if you want, if you're mapping not into RD but into a Hilbert space, say for example, if you're replacing RD by a Hilbert space, then you can give the integral on the right hand side, of course, the interpretation of a weak integral, which we discussed in the first chapter. So I'm if you're uncomfortable with weak integrals, always think of RD. Actually, the application we are going to see is coming from an even easier space, so it will come from R2. But it's no problem to formulate all of the results for, let's say, continuous mappings with values in Hilbert spaces, or actually in arbitrary locally convex and suitably complete spaces, where we can make sense of the integral on the right-hand side as a weak integral. Okay, now after we have all of these technicalities out of the way, let's take a look at the chapter. So what do we want to do in this chapter? So let's take a look. So in applications, in shape analysis, the L2 metric is very popular. Let's put it like this. So what is this we are talking about? So if MG is a strong Riemannian manifold, then the L2 metric on smooth functions from the unit circle with values in M is given as GC L2 of two functions f and g. This is the integral over s1 g theta f theta g theta d theta, right? Okay, so several comments here. A strong Riemannian manifold admits a local addition for those who know the what it is. The local addition is the Riemannian exponential map. Okay, so basically this is a comment for you, Nathan. If you don't know what this is, don't worry. I mean, we are the whole exposition here tries to avoid the Riemannian exponential map. So we are not going to talk about this. So it's due to some theory, which I'm not going to explain to you, there is a local addition. So this means, or what are the consequences? First consequence is this space is a canonical manifold. Also, this space is a canonical manifold, and we have this isomorphism. And finally, we can iterate this whole procedure. We actually need also the second order tangent bundle. Yeah, sorry. Here we only have an M. Right, so we can identify the higher tangent or all the tangent bundles of C infinity S1 with values in M, with C infinity function from S1 with values in the tangent bundle. And we as we've seen this before. And okay, so the nice thing here is now, of course, that in the first approximation, this formula above here makes sense, because what this identification again gives us, so C, the subscript here, this is an element in the C infinity function from S1 with values in M. F and G are now supposed to come from the tangent space sitting over C, and we see that, I mean, what is the interpretation here? So the we can interpret F and G again as functions from S1 which take values in Tm and which are sitting over the C. So actually this is, we are abusing here a little bit notation in this. So of course we can apply the Riemannian metric to the vector components of F and G, right? And this is what the formula is supposed to mean. And then we integrate over this Riemannian metric. So this is the L2 metric, and this is right, and we see that G L2, so this needs to be a smooth mapping on S1 M Whitney sum with itself going to the reals. However, here, to see that this is really smooth, we can use this this trick we have seen in the lecture on the Whitney sum. So we know that this is isomorphic to S1 M, S1 Tm Whitney sum with Tm, right? And now let's look at the formula. So here we have the reals. Obviously, the reals are the reals. So let's look at the formula. What is happening here? So we are taking two elements in the identification. So we are taking a mapping which takes values in the Whitney sum. So f and g are now the components of this mapping f is always supposed to take its values in the first piece of the Whitney sum, and g is always supposed to take its values in the second piece of the Whitney sum. And where are we sending it? We're basically sending it to g star. So push forward of g with f and g, right? Okay, so this is a so the since the Riemannian matrix, so this g here is a strong Riemannian matrix. On M, or in other words, G from TM, Whitney sum with TM, with values in R, is smooth. So the push forward with this Riemannian metric is smooth, because it's a smooth map. So we have a smooth map. Where does this stuff end up? So this ends up in the smooth mappings from S1, with values in the reals. And now what we have to do is we have to compose it with a mapping. Let me suggestively write here the S1 integral. So we are integrating out over S1. And so the integral with S1, what does it do? So it takes, in this case, a smooth function from S1. With values in the reals, and it goes into the reals, and it, so we take some function, let's call it h, and send it to the integral from 0 to 2 pi f of cosine of t sine of t dt, right? And so this is continuous and linear mapping, therefore it's smooth. Right, and how do you get the continuity? I mean, actually, you can make your life a little bit simpler. So this mapping, integral from S1, C infinity, S1, the reals. So this actually factors through the continuous mappings. And there we have a similar mapping, which does the integration. Right, and now so here this space carries the compact open topology, and this is a continuous and linear mapping which goes down here, which is basically it's forgetting that the mappings are smooth, right? So this is what is happening with the downward arrow. We're just realizing all of the continuous smooth mappings as continuous mappings and forget that they were smooth. And however, so it's perhaps easier to see that this integral operator from S1 with values in the reals to the reals is continuous. Why is this easier? So the compact open topology, what is the mode of convergence with respect to this compact open topology? This is uniform convergence on compact sets, right? And so now you're asked, well, if I'm starting here with some fn converging towards an n, so I need to show that then also the integral of fn, let's write d theta here, that also the integral converges to the integral of f d theta s1, right? And I mean, up to the parametrization change, this should be this should look like a familiar theorem. So you so here the convergence is in the sense of compact convergence, uniform convergence. And then there's a theorem: if you have a series of functions which uniformly converges to another function, then also the integrals, say the Riemann integrals or whatever you we have there, converge uniformly to converge to each other. So this is why, I mean, this is a sketch of how do you see that this is a continuous operator. And the whole trick why you want to forget about the smooth functions, I mean, it, of course, you could, of course, pull off the same trick on the C infinity functions. The reason why I was factoring it through the continuous functions was because I wanted to appeal to a known theorem. And the topology here, the compact open topology, is perhaps easier to handle than the compact open C infinity topology, which in this case would actually not be a problem. Because, I mean, if it's, so the compact open topology is coarser than the compact open C infinity topology. And if we can prove it in the compact open topology, then obviously it's also true in the compact open C infinity topology. Anyway, so the upshot of this whole thing is that this really is a smooth map from the Whitney sum of these spaces to R. And the trick which was essential to see this is because we needed the smoothness of the push forward is to identify the Whitney sum of the tangent bundles with the smooth functions which take values in the Whitney sum. So this is for every strong Riemannian manifold actually a weak Riemannian metric. So this L2 metric, this is what the whole upshot was about. I mean, and smoothness was the thing which was let's say, well, perhaps not problematic, but at least we needed to discuss this once. Okay, and now let's our goal now is twofold. First of all, we want to show that the L2 metric admits a spray, a connector, and a covariant derivative. So all of these items exist for this weak Riemannian metric. And the second thing we want to do then is to give an insight of how is GL2 related to shape analysis. But let's first try to work out the properties of this weak Riemannian metric, and let's start with an easy construction. So let MG be a strong Riemannian manifold. With metric spray S and connector K. Okay, let's do a short recap. Recall that S has an associated bilinear form B, and K is given by the formula. So so this is a mapping from T square M to TM, which takes locally, I'm writing down the local formula, takes this to X W minus B U, so locally, on, let's say, a chart domain, BU X VW. So this is a formula for the connector, and every spray determines uniquely this connector. And so the covariant derivative associated to the spray is then covariant derivative X, Y. The formula for this guy was you apply the connector to the tangent mapping of Y, and then you apply X. So this is these formula. So here we have the connector, and this is the important formula. And so this is connector determined by the spray and covariant derivative determined by this formula from the spray. Those are the important formula, and we will be coming back to them. Okay, right. So we have a strong Riemannian manifold, we have a metric spray, and we have a connector. Then we consider, I mean, basically, what we are going to do, looking at the formula for the L2 metric, we see that in a certain sense, what is happening here, I mean, up to this integration process, the Riemannian metric has been lifted from the manifold M to this manifolds of mappings, to the C infinity functions from S1, which take values in M. And, perhaps a natural idea, if I claim that now this weak Riemannian metric, the weak L2 metric, has a spray and a connector, would be, let's try to lift the spray and the connector, and perhaps somehow also the metric derivative, to the manifolds of mappings. And for the spray and the connector, there's a straightforward way of doing this. So for the spray, for example, recall the spray was a mapping from Tm taking values in T square M. And we can just take the push forward. This gives us a well-defined mapping on the C infinity functions from S1 with values in Tm to the C infinity functions from S1 with values in T square M. And note that since we can interpret these Tm spaces as the tangent spaces, so we can interpret S star as a map from T C infinity S1 with values in M to T squared C infinity from S1 with values in, not T, with values in M. Right? And so what we see here is that this push forward of the spray is a mapping of the right type when we are searching for a spray on the C infinity functions. Okay, and similarly, we can take the push forward of the connector. This gives us something on the C infinity functions from S1 with values in T square M to the C infinity functions from S1 with values in Tm. And again, since this is isomorphic to T square C infinity S1 M, and the right hand side is isomorphic to T C infinity S1 M. So what we see here that also the connector has the right signature. And we get immediately that these push forwards are smooth mappings because of the canonical manifold structure on all of these guys. And so let's say it's easy to see that S star and K star define spray and a connector on the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M. So, and whenever I'm writing, it's easy to see what this means. This is an exercise. So this is a nice exercise to go back to: what is the definition of the spray? What is the definition of a connector? How do you see this for those two things? That they actually form a spray and a connector on this infinite dimensional manifold. However, at this moment, we don't know that the S star and the K star belong to each other. So what do I mean by this? We've started here in this small recollection, and we said, so we have this spray S and the connector K. And we said K is the associated connector because it satisfies the formula. Well, it's given basically by the associated bilinear form via this yellow formula we have here. Right? And so we know this formula for S and K, but we do not yet know the formula for S star and K star. Looking just from the outside of this, it should be clear that K star is the associated connector of S star, because point-wise, this is true. However, since there are many surprises in these infinite dimensional manifolds of mapping setting, let's write this as a proposition. So in the situation of 4, 4, 1, the connector associated to S star is K star. And let me give you an argument for this, or at least sketch most of the argument, and then some verifications I leave to you, again, as an exercise. But let's see. So by definition, the connector of S star is uniquely determined by the associated bilinear form B, let's label this BS star. Okay. Right, let's just briefly go up again here. So we have this formula here, which determines the connector, and we see that as soon as we know what the associated bilinear form is, we know what the connector is, because we can just write down the formula. From the formula for K star, we know what we really would like the connector of S star to be. So looking at this formula here, what we want is we want to show that BS star is given by the push forward of B, because this is exactly what K star is doing. So it's basically, I mean, when you look at the formula here, if you put a star next to the K, so you're inserting in all the arguments, you're inserting functions. And so basically, if we can show that that the associated bilinear form of S star is the push forward of B, then we know immediately that that K star will be the connector associated to S star. And in a certain sense, this makes sense, right? Because we are pushing forward the spray, so in a certain sense, what we are doing here is when passing from the manifold M to this manifold of mappings of the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M, we are just adding a parameter. It's a little bit like what we have seen in the computation of regularity for the current groups, right? So there, in all of the computations, the domain of the current group was only appearing as an additional parameter in all of the calculations. And this is it's exactly the same idea here. The only thing which is difficult and where we need a small trick or to take a little bit of a different perspective is the following problem. So when you look at here at the associated bilinear form, How is this associated by linear form defined? Basically, it's defined on chart domains or trivializations by computing these guys BU. And now everything would be super simple if the charts of the manifolds of mappings from the C infinity function from S1 with values in M would be somehow coming from the charts on M. But we have seen in the construction of the manifolds of mapping that the charts of the manifolds of mappings are not coming from the charts of the target manifold. So we cannot just immediately say, well, everything is just a push forward with stuff, and this is clear from the formula. So we need to be a little bit more clever to see this. And the idea here is to not use this local formulation because we don't have any good local charts where we can compute. But to do the following, so let me show this to you. Oh, this is wrong. So to compute BS star, we need to compute the second derivative in the second direction of S star at some bundle trivialization x naught dot, right? So remember from yesterday that locally this associated by linear form was given by this red formula here, right? So we need to take the derivative of something. Again, this is a local formula, so we have the problem that we really don't want to go into the trivializations of the manifolds of mappings, because that's a lot of a hassle, because then we have to compose with it with a local addition. We have to identify stuff with respect to the local addition. This can be done in principle, but it's tedious and a lot of work, to put it like this. So let's just state where S star O2 is the local representative. On trivialization O of C infinity S1 TM, right? And basically the whole idea of this proof will be to avoid going into local trivializations at all costs, right? Because then we are not seeing anything. Okay, however, let's just look at the S star for a moment. So this is a mapping from C infinity S1 TM taking values in C infinity S1 T square M. Okay, and so we wish to compute derivatives of a local representative, but still we want to compute derivatives. Okay, looking at this, you should immediately, I mean, after we've now done a good portion of the course, you should get immediately an idea. We want to derivate a partial map of this S star, or I mean, from the perspective of the infinite dimensional manifold, we want to compute parts of the tangent mapping of the S star. Aha. And it goes into a manifold of mappings. And this is the key. So instead of looking at the S star, we can just use the exponential law and look at the mapping S star wedge. So this is a mapping from C infinity S1 TM taking times S1 with values in T square M. Right? So this is the associated map, and it does H theta gets mapped to S of H of theta. Okay, so this is the mapping. And now the second observation we need is the derivatives we are seeking to compute are only derivatives with respect to the H. With respect to H. Yeah, so the theta here is really just an additional parameter. We don't need the theta, or we never need to take derivatives with respect to theta. So in principle, we can treat this whole differential problem as a problem, as a parameterized problem, and we are good if we can solve it for every single theta. And now basically what this means is, well, basically I can, so we can freeze theta and work with derivatives of S. And so upshot of this, if we treat if we can treat S1 as a parameter set, and the desired formula holds since it can be checked pointwise for every theta. And this is an exercise. 4, 5, 1 apparently, where you do the details. This is a little bit of a subtle point. I recommend really that you do try to do the exercise and see for yourself what is going on, because this is, I mean, this is actually not much of a differentiability problem. It's just an identification problem. So we need to understand what this identification under the exponential law is again doing to the spray, and what is happening if we're differentiating. So I really recommend that you look at this exercise and try to work it out for yourself. But since this is an important point I wanted to make, you can find a solution to this, and sort of the full computation can be found in the solution chapter at the end of the notes. Okay. However, what this, I mean, if you haven't done it before, this computation that the K star is the associated connector of the S star shows also that the K star is a connector at all. So you could skip the by hands proof that the K star gives you a connector and just derive it from the fact that it turns out to be the associated connector of the spray S star. Okay. So however, now we have checked this tedious detail, and let's go further. So what we we now have basically a spray and a connector which are associated to each other, so they are connected. Okay, they are connected with each other, and we do not yet know is S star and K star associated to the L2 metric. We strongly suspect that this is the case because everything is built basically by push forwards, but we don't know. And is there a covariant derivative? Let me just say, sort of naively, you might think, can I not just push forward the covariant derivative? But the covariant derivative is something which lives on vector fields times vector fields on M, and spits out a vector field on M. The covariant derivative we seek is, let's write this as covariant derivative L2. This is something, it takes vector fields on the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M squared to the vector fields on the C infinity functions from S1 in M. And while we can think of the contribution of S1 just again as a parameter set, it's not directly apparent of how a push forward of the mapping nabla on the vector fields would help us to get a covariant derivative on the C infinity functions. So at least it's not clear to me. If you know a way to do this, then be my guest and enlighten me. But I've thought a little bit about it, and I don't think there's a way to do this. Okay. However, so let us now construct a covariant derivative for the smooth functions from S1 with values in M. And then once we have all of these items in place, what we are going to do is we are going to show that S star, K star, and this new covariant derivative we are building are actually the right objects for our L2 metric. So this will be the idea. Okay, and unfortunately, the covariant derivative is more complicated. As I said, I don't think that you can just push forward something here and be done. So we need to climb a little bit. So let us now begin building this covariant derivative. So let F from N to M be a smooth map. And N is just an arbitrary manifold. And let's assume we have some S, a map, which is smooth from N with values in Tm and is sitting over F. So recall these are the smooth functions from N to Tm such that if I compose them with the bundle projection, I get back the base F. And let's say we have a vector field on N. Then we define a covariant derivative depending on G of X of the S. And how do we do this? We use the connector. So we use X, we use TS. Right? So far, so good. The only thing which has changed is, usually in the usual formula for the covariant derivative, we would take T of a vector field. S is now not a vector field, but it takes values in the double tangent bundle of M. And so we press that down again using the connector of G. And type-wise, this is a mapping from N taking values in Tm, right? And so let's call this 410, this equation. And we will use this. We will use this definition. This is something like a covariant derivative for a vector field along a smooth map. You could prove that it has similar properties than the covariant than you would expect from a covariant derivative. But let's wait for a moment with this. We will now exploit the exponential law. For the C infinity functions from S1 to M. So we see that S is in the C infinity functions from from what? So let S now be something in the C infinity functions from N to the C infinity functions from S1 to Tm. Right? Okay. So to this map, we associate the S wedge, and this is now a C infinity function from N times S1 with values in Tm. Sorry, I needed to say that we are exploiting the exponential law for when we have a Tm here, but this is okay. Okay. And now let's have a look at the situation now. So we have our formula 410, which says something for mappings along a given mapping, which take values in TM. However, this formula is defined only for maps taking or having domain N. And here the domain is different. So we have the N here, but we also have a copy of the S1. So actually this whole problem we are facing now is similar to another thing we have seen when we were identifying the Lie algebra of the diffeomorphism group. We had a very similar problem that once we applied the exponential law, we had a thing which was defined on a Cartesian product with a factor too much. I mean, here the S1 factor is actually too much. And the solution there was we extended, I mean, so here the X, this X here, is a vector field on N, right? And our formula is for vector fields on N, not for vector fields on N times S1. However, the trick we are going to use is we extend the vector field X in. So this is a vector field N as X times the zero vector field on S1. This is now a vector field on N times S1. This should look familiar when you think back of how we identified the Lie algebra. The reason why this is not really changing anything is that in all the constructions which are now to follow, the derivatives and so forth we are going to evaluate, they get fed a zero in the S1 component. And the point is, if you have a linear mapping and you're feeding it zero, this turns out to be zero. So actually, when we are inserting zero in the second components, this will not change anything. And now as a last thing before we stop, let me just define now what the formula for the covariant derivative is. Okay, so let's see how this formula works out. So 4 is a covariant derivative. On the smooth functions from S1 with values in M. Okay. Right. And what we do is now we choose N to be equal to the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M and define via 410, so this equation we had, a map Nabla, let's call it Nabla G, X times the zero vector field on S1, and we want to apply this to S wedge, and this is a smooth mapping from the C infinity function on S1 with values in M times the S1 functions, and then it takes values in TM. And so this is not the covariant derivative we are after. What we define now is will turn out to be the covariant derivative. So this will be covariant derivative in the direction of X of S will be defined now as the following. So we take this guy here we have had before, X times 0 S1 of S wedge, and pipe it once more through the exponential law, and this is now a smooth function from the smooth function from S1 with values in TM to the smooth functions sorry, not with values in Tm, with values in m. So this is the point. With values in the smooth function from S1, with values in Tm. Okay. So, and so this is formula 411. And this looks complicated enough. So what I claim is this is, okay, we have to check several things. On one hand, we will check that this actually is a covariant derivative, which is not as straightforward as, or it will turn out that we can do this with a little trick. And so this is a covariant derivative, and we will seen later that this guy here is actually the covariant derivative associated to the L2 metric. But let's first do a little sanity check. Is the result a vector field? Under the condition that if, let's look at S, so S is a mapping from the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M to the C infinity functions from S1 with values in Tm. We know, of course, that this is the tangent bundle of S1 Tm. And if this is a vector field. What this means is we are requiring that if I compose with the push forward of the bundle projection, this is the identity on the C infinity functions from S1 to M. So what I want to prove now as a sanity check first is that if I project this guy down, then I get the I get really what I want. I get a vector field on the C infinity functions. Okay, so let's try. So first of all, we take the bundle projection of the C infinity functions from S1 with M and compose this with this guy. So we hope that this gives us actually the identity on the C infinity functions. What is this guy? Note, we have identified the spaces. So this is just the push forward with pi m. Okay, and now let's bite into the bullet and just insert the definition. So this is Nabla G X times zero vector field on S1 S wedge V. Okay, now there is a nice formula. What happens if you push forward with a mapping and then the mapping you're pushing forward is a mapping which arises from this taking the V operation? It turns out that this is the same as if we just applied the mapping here to whatever is sitting inside of the V operation. And afterwards, take the V. So this is an exercise which fits into the second chapter. And I added it as an exercise into the new version of the script. It wasn't there as an exercise when we did chapter 2. So however, there's a reference. And it's actually not hard to see that this is true. So you're just inserting the definitions and see that if you have a star outside of a V, you can take it inside. You can take the mapping, which is starred inside the V for the price of omitting the star and just writing composition. Okay, and now let's do more calculations. So we know that, okay, first of all, we have to take the outer bracket, so with pi of m. And now we are taking the definition of this guy and see what's happening. Okay, let's briefly check. What was the definition? the definition of this guy is given via 410. So it's basically the connector composed with TS, composed with X, and so forth. And if you're working out what this is, so you're getting here, so you compose with the connector, you compose with TS wedge, because this is what we had here, and then you compose with X times the zero vector field on S1. So this is everything we get from the red part, and then you have to V afterwards. Okay, so let's have a look. What does that mean? It turns out there is a nice formula for this guy, and this is now exercise 4.5.2. Says what is the formula for this guy? Well, turns out it's the following. It's TS composed with X, and we have to wedge this one. Okay, now this is looking much better if we believe this formula, right? So we have pi m composed with k composed with ts composed with x wedge, and then we V it. Okay, and now we do the following trick reverse. We have said when taking in the star into this guy, to the V, then we just get the simple composition. Now we have a simple composition here, and we just want to take it out of the V. And what this gives us is we just take the star of this one, and then we are left with, so we apply this to TS composed with X wedge, and then we have to V the whole thing. However, taking the wedge and the V, they are inverse operations to each other. So what happens if I take first the wedge and then afterwards the V? Well, it turns out that they cancel. Okay, great. So we have this guy now. Okay, and now if you just insert points and see what's going to happen here is, so by evaluating in, let's say, X, V, local coordinates, the following becomes clear. If I just evaluate what this is, take the definition of the connector, take the definition of the projection, and so forth, this is just the identity on the C infinity functions from S1 with values in M. So indeed, if pi M star of S is the identity of the C infinity functions from S1 with M. There is no clever way of seeing this. You just have to insert points and compute. So this shows that 4.11, so the formula for this covariant derivative, induces a bilinear map, which we call Nabla, on the vector fields of the C infinity functions from S1 to M squared to the vector fields of the C infinity functions from S1 to M. Okay. And well, at least this sanity check holds. We don't know yet that this really is the this really is a covariant derivative. It's just now a mapping which is bilinear and maps vectors fields on the C infinity functions to vector fields on the C infinity functions. And the next proposition will bring everything together. We will see that Nabla is a covariant derivative. Its associated connector is actually this the push forward with k. So this covariant derivative has then a connector, which is k with a push forward with k. We know therefore already, because k star is the connector associated to s star, we know that the covariant derivative is thus the associated covariant derivative of the s star. So we what we'll see in the next section is, so nabla is the covariant derivative induced by k star, stars lower, and similarly, it is the covariant derivative induced by s star. So the next proposition will show exactly this, and we will see that that this covariant derivative is actually the associated covariant derivative to the S star. And once we know this, we will then prove that this covariant derivative is also the metric derivative of the L2 metric, which we have just defined. Okay, but we'll take a little break here and resume.